back to our today's speaker, Mr. Jitendra Solanki, sir. Thank you so much. And he's a founder of Plan Special Needs, SEBI Registered Investment Advisor, CFP and CTP, founder and director at Special Needs State Planner Private Limited. He is going to guide us on how to answer what after you. So over to you, sir.
Thank you.
Share my screen. Yes, you can share.
Okay, so we are talking on what after us. So largely we are not going deep into, you know, all those estate planning aspect, but we are looking at more in today's discussion, you know, how to go about planning what after us, right? And what are the concerns, what are the areas you have to look into when you are answering this question. Now, before, you know, you plan out for a lifetime of your child after you, we always say that it's very important, and you can only, you know, do that once you understand the life stages of your child. Now, this is a timeline we have drawn, and this is a timeline which is basis of all our, you know, advisory we do, and we help families that need to understand the life stages of, you know, from right from the beginning, you know, of the child life, and how these life stages, you know, will come, and what all aspects, you know, would be there. So like what we did is, you know, we divided into five life stages: minority, living at home, external living environment, first parent death, the second parent death, and the end of child life. Now, this complete lifetime, if you can draw this timeline, you are able to identify the areas you need to think about when you have to plan that what's going to happen after me, right? What's going to happen to what after us. Now, what after us can only be answered when you know what are the areas you require, you need to address. And that can come in when you draw a timeline like this, because at each every life stage, there is some action plan for you. There is some thinking for you. There is something which needs to be addressed. It may be on personal side, it may be on financial side, and it may be on the legal side. For example, during the child minority, your focus is more on, you know, the diagnosis is there, early intervention, counseling, therapies. When you move, you know, to when the child is moving to an external living environment, probably, you know, towards residential care, then child adaptability, residential facilities, the financial support, and when death of one parent happens, and you know, the will come into picture, the trust will come into picture, the probate is there. So by this timeline, it helps you identify the areas. And that's where you come to know that when I am answering a question like what after me, then what I need to look at. Now, what are the concerns, largely we go through? So lifelong support for the special needs child, you know, how this lifelong support will be provided, who all would be there, who can provide this support. So today you have a support system built in. So would it be there for the lifelong? If not, then what will move out and what can come in? So how do you provide this lifelong support? The regular expenses of childcare for lifetime. So there is a huge financial angle involved for, you know, childcare after your lifetime. So how these regular expenses, will shape up, and how these can be provided for. Are available resources adequate to provide for the, you know, the child financially? So how, you know, from where these finances would come from, and whatever resources you have built or you are going to build in the future, are these adequate? Who will manage the child affairs after us? So the bigger question is that, you know, who is going to be there, who will manage the affairs, both on personal side and both on, you know, financial side. Where will the child live? Now, this is the most important question, because this will answer a lot many queries. So So where is the child going to live? We are going to look at, you know, what do you do when you think about this question? How can we provide a security to the child? So both on financial and personal, how the living of my child would be secure, both on personal side and on the financial side. And what if? So there is always, you know, question mark on whatever we are planning. So what if other sides of, you know, things happen? Is there a solution for that? These are the concerns of, you know, revolving around our life. And mostly, you know, we are thinking on when we are managing our child affairs, and is the answer we are looking at. We will try to address some of these answers today. I don't say these are the complete solutions, but largely this is the thinking, or these are the thought process you should go about the direction. Now, the first important question of when you are answering what after me is the residential living, because that will answer your most of the questions revolving around you. The residential living of the child, what happens after you? Where would he stay? You know, is he going to stay in the own house? Are you, whether it's a new house or if your existing house, you know, whether it will require modification? What is the services availability? Which city you live in? You know, where do you live in? What is the service availability? There are service providers there. So there are parents who are from metros. There are parents who are from the smaller cities. Now there is a difference between the service availability. So what happens? You know, do you move to other cities? What is the cost of care which is involved when the child is going to live in the own house? So what is the cost of care? Because when the child is living in her own house, more of professionals would involve, whether it's a maid, whether it's a driver, you know, whether it's a therapist or any other, you know, service providers. Is there an organization which is going to provide all the kinds of services? You know, we do have models in India coming up where the child is living in your own house and there are service providers who will provide all the services. And the funds availability. So where would these funds would, you know, come from? Whether you, if you want to buy a house, the other option is they're shifting to a residential care. So the child is not living in the own house, but shifting to a residential care. Then an analysis would come in. You know, what is the type of care which is provided in the residential living? You know, what are the services? What is the security of that residential care? The staff, the ratio versus the number of children you have. Now, whether the residential care has only hostel facilities or it's for facilities for the families also, and if it is there in both, you know, ways, what are the number of ratio of numbers staff to the number of children, and what is the continuity of the residential care? So what is the vision of the founders, because that will tell you that what the long-term continuity of the residential living center. Then the child adaptability. Is the child going to be comfortable? Because when you answer your question, what after us? So how do you make the child, you know, comfortable in the residential care? And that question will come in, you know, when you decide when to shift. Are you going to shift along with the child, you know, probably pre-retirement or after retirement or now, or you are leaving an option that after your lifetime, the child is going to shift to the residential care. If that is a question, then how do you address the child comfortability there? Okay. And the funding, how the funding would be provided to the residential care. So this residential living is the most important question which families have to answer, because when this is answered, this also gives you, leads a direction towards other aspects of, especially the legal part, when you are answering the question that what's going to happen after me. Because the kind of living, residential living you choose, you know, for your child will decide the kind of ecosystem you built, you know, for him or her, which will manage the, or which will provide the continuity of managing the child affairs till lifetime. Six elements largely, you know, which we think, you know, it covers planning, you know, for your child affairs. The first one is the life care plan. The life care plan would largely be revolve around, as I said, you know, the choosing a residential care, the finances available, the personal life, you know, his behavioral change, his adaptability. So that all will come under life care plan. So when you are when you are drawing this life care plan, you are addressing all those queries. Then there is the financial plan. Every aspect of your planning has got a financial angle involved. And without a financial plan, even if you have answered a question, what after me, without a financial plan, it would be incomplete, because whatever framework you decide, it's have a financial angle towards it. You need finances, you know, to ensure that the security you are looking at, along with the personal security, the financial security would also be there. Estate plan would help you answer a question, you know, that what is the kind of framework you should build to ensure to provide a secure future for your child after your lifetime. Communication plan is, there are stakeholders involved. I'm going to talk about stakeholders. There are stakeholders involved. How do you communicate about your child to these stakeholders? Because everybody will play a role. A residential care has a role. If you know, set up a private trust would have a role. A legal guardian would have a role. There would be family members, you know, friends, relatives, support system, who all will have a role. How do you communicate to all of them about your, you know, child care? And that's where you need to draw a communication plan, that this is how you're going to, you know, this is what you can provide to them, which will ensure that all of them are at the same you know, page whenever they are interacting with your child or whenever they are thinking about your child future. Transition plan. Now, transition plan is, there are transition phases in your child. You know, minority to adult, when the child is moving from minority to adult, then, you know, there would be a change in behavior. You might have to change support staff. You know, similarly, moving from residential home, your own home, to a residential center, then it's a transition phase, because, you know, the child adaptability, again, the child behavior, you know, would be there. Relocating, you might relocate from metro to a smaller city. Service, you know, what service you look at, what kind of schools you look at, you know, and other aspects of that. All these transition phases are important, because this will come irrespective of whether you are there or not there. The transition phases will come in your child life. So when you are looking at a transition plan, you are trying to address identifying these transition phases and trying to address that, you know, what solution you can have to address those transition phases. For example, child moving to minority to major. Now there is a change in behavior. There would be other aspects which will require, you know, review of whatever services you are you know, taking for your child care. Then if it is left to the next legal guardian, you know, he will have to decide. He might not have a awareness about your child. How do you make that? How do you bridge that gap? So that's where transition plan is important. And the benefit plan. What benefit? Identifying the all benefits you can receive and inculcating in your planning when you are answering a question, what after us. So there might be a financial help coming from parents, grandparents, or, you know, friends, relatives. There would be other benefits, like, you know, your employer benefit. So analyzing all those and then, you know, inculcating into your planning. So these, now why I'm mentioning these six elements is that when you look at this six element, you are addressing most of the aspects. And it's not only, so financial is not only an angle, there is a personal angle involved, there are emotional aspects involved, there are legal aspects involved. As I said, there are communication you know, gap which might come in. The transition phases have to be understood well. So all these elements are important when you want to answer what after me. And we generally have a six a self-assessment, you know, for parents to know that how much you are prepared for your child future and what are the areas you need to plan. So when you do this six assessment, it contains questions from all these areas. Questions which will help you to, you know, answer that this is what, or to identify this is what I am, you know, this is what I need to plan. This is what I haven't done. So when you are thinking of about your child future, especially after your lifetime, you need to answer these questions yourself, because this is what you will communicate to the future caregivers or guardian or trustees. What is the nature of child disability and how will it change with the life stages of the child. And that's why I talked about initially the life stages, understanding the life stages, because it helps you to answer this question. Will the disability allow the child to earn in future? So again, you know, this is with respect to the financial aspects, or probably the, you know, the independent living of the child without, you know, much of support. So this question is important, that which will tell you, you know, how much the child can be comfortable. Where will the child live post parents' lifetime? I have spoken about the residential living. So this question is, you know, becomes important. Who will manage the child affairs post parents' lifetime? And how will the expenses of the child shape up in the near future? The financial angle has to come in, because though you look for any legal framework, you decide for it, but it's important that how, you know, the expenses part comes in your planning. Who will decide if you can't? So this question needs an answer. That's probably, you know, we are looking at that. Who will decide if I'm not able to decide? Now the law has a very defined structure. There is, in the law, it's very clearly written that if you do not decide, then who can decide? So if you do not decide about your child guardianship, then the law will decide. If you do not decide about, you know, your financial toward the child, the law will decide as per, you know, what is written in the law, which might not be beneficial to your child. So that's where, you know, it's important that whatever we do not leave anything unaddressed. We plan it and not leave, you know, at the mercy of law to decide that, you know, who's going to care for your child. And that's where estate plan come into picture. By drawing an estate plan, you actually identify the areas which are important or which will help you in planning for your child care after your lifetime. So I name it Vijay Shekhar estate plan. Now the first element is living arrangement for the child. Home, if he is going to live at home, do you need to purchase? If yes, then what are the funds required and what are the sources of the funds? If the child is going to live in the residential care, what is the cost of stay? Can the child stay alone? If yes, sorry. Shift now or later? If no, then what? Then Vijay has to shift. If Vijay is going to shift earlier, before retirement, what are the job opportunities? You know, how the income flow would happen. The legal guardianship, the child turns 18, you have to apply for legal guardianship. But who after you? You have to appoint in the will. If you do not appoint in the will, then the law will decide. The legal guardianship will go to the court. And there might be you know, legal issues there. Write a will, how, you know, the assets will be distributed. So like Vijay decided asset to wife, or asset to the trust if wife predeceases Vijay. Similarly, wife writes a will, assets to Vijay, assets to trust if Vijay predeceases, and guardianship provision. So you, in the will, you create a guardianship provision that this person is going to be the guardian for my child, managing his personal affairs if I am not there tomorrow. Form a trust. Arjun is the child of Vijay. So Arjun trust, trustees, Vijay and spouse, successor trustees, who you decide. Who's going to be the successor trustees, you identify. When Arjun dies, when the child, you know, after the trust objective, so the trust objective is met there, then the asset distribution, how does it happen? Should it go to the legal heir or to charity, or, you know, whatever decision you take. And the letter of intent, which is basically the communication plan, medical history, daily life, your dreams for the child, and you discuss with family members. So like this, you plan, you create an estate plan, which not only give you a framework, but actually may give you, you know, an answer that what after you. I'm not going deep into residential care, what kind of residential care, you know, those are separate discussions which are happening. But I'm largely talking on the plan you have to create. Within this plan, you will have to then go deep into everything, like living arrangement for the child. You will have to go deep and analyze, you know, home, existing home, then look at services available in your city or another city. If it is another city, not your city, you know, maybe you might have to relocate. Then what is the cost? I know when you have to relocate. So all these questions will need to be answered. But largely, this estate plan is required to answer that what after me. Vision, everything is defined. You have need to have a vision, you know, for your child, and that vision, every parent has got a vision for, you know, for their child, but it needs to be communicated so that the future caregivers, the future guardian, the trustees know about it. And when you draw a letter of intent, you actually create a vision, because you describe about your child and then you write, this is what I want for my child. So family, about members, history, your vision, living, daily routine, habits, your vision for lifestyle, residential, current residence, your chosen option, what is not going to work, healthcare, medication, therapies, hospital visit, what did not work in the past, social activities about your child, sport, dance, vacation, extracurricular, education, special school, special classes, vocational courses, religious interest of your child, places of interest, his or her likes or dislike, and final arrangement. If you look at, you have described about your child life when you are writing a letter of intent and you are giving a vision. This is my child and this is what I dream for my child. Now, when this is communicated to the next legal guardian or the next, the trustees, they are probably aware and the decision making for them is more efficient. And this is probably, I would say, the first document you create when you are thinking or when you're planning what after us. Create a letter of intent first, because you do not want to leave your child to somebody who's not aware about your child affairs. And so we created a complete online e-course where you can just create this letter of intent in 10 days. Then come the stakeholders. It's important to understand who are all going to be the stakeholders. The stakeholders would be people involved in your child care. So there would be legal guardian. Now, who can be legal guardian? Individuals, family members, friends, NGOs, like an option the National Trust has, registered with National Trust as allowed by the court, or one of the trustees set up in the trust deed. So whichever way, as per the legal provision, you decide to appoint a guardian. The trustees, who's going to manage the financial affairs, the guardian will take care of the personal affairs. Then there is a support system, family members, friends, parents, community, who will fulfill the above role when in need. So they would come in whenever there is a need to support your child. And there are service providers, the residential living centers, medical professional, financial and legal professional, which ensures the quality of life to your child. These are the stakeholders. And when you are planning, I work on each of the stakeholders. And all these stakeholders combined together is going to provide us security to your child. And when you are answering that question, you know, what after us, when you have identified these stakeholders, then you will be able to complete or answer that question. Now, with these stakeholders, again, I just go one step forward where I say that all these stakeholders have to be aligned with each other. They have to be aligned with each other's role, because guardian need to understand what's happening with the trust, how the financials are coming, the service providers. If there is a demand from service providers, the legal guardian will have to understand where this demand is coming. And similarly, the support system also have to be aware. And you create an ecosystem which ensure that all these stakeholders come in alignment with each other. Now, how this ecosystem works is that the trust becomes a main entity. The trust set up contracts, with service providers, with other stakeholders, and there is, under this ecosystem, there is a periodic review system which is put in place. Access to that is available to all those family members, legal guardian, who's going to decide the child affairs. So like this ecosystem, when you create, so this ecosystem ensures that all of the stakeholders are aware about the child affairs. So tomorrow, if there is, suppose a health emergency comes in and the child is living in a residential care, now the legal guardian has to decide personally. He has to sign the documents in the hospital. Secondly, the trust has to provide the funds. Now, legal guardian need to know how this health emergency is arising, and the trust needs to know how this, funds would be required. So when this ecosystem is created, you have a periodic review system kind of a process, then the decision making is more efficient. So this I'll probably skip. We are helping families in both financial and legal aspects at different levels. PSN Life Plan System is a life plan which caters to all the different aspects and help you prepare for the future. Right. So this is about what after us. As I said, I have not got deep into each of those. That's a separate presentations altogether, but largely have addressed that what it is required you to understand to answer this question. Now, this answer cannot be question, this question cannot be answered straightforward, but it has to come by understanding the child life stages. That would probably be the first step. And then step by step, you will be able to answer questions by involving professionals. Happy to answer questions which are there.
Yes, if anybody has question, please raise your hands. We can take up one by one. Yeah, Ujwal Shah ji, aap sakte hain.
Yeah, my question is, what if this legal guardian tries to play mischievous or tries to utilize the funds or tries to do something which is not in line with the child's requirements post us? Who will be the one who would take care of it?
Okay, so there is a monitoring system by the National Trust. I won't say a monitoring system, but when a legal guardianship is taken from the National Trust, so legal guardian has to submit financial documents related to the child every year. Okay, that is actually a balance sheet which shows that what are the assets in the name of the child, what has been sold, what is remained. I think that is one monitoring system you can say which is there, because if LLC found there is a huge diversion for the funds for the child, they can pose a question to that. But otherwise, the matter will go to the court. There is no as such monitoring authority which is set up in the legal guardian, because it is from the court. So yes, somebody will have to complain to the court, or then only this matter will be taken up.
Yes, Sarita Gupta ma'am, you can unmute and ask your
yeah. Hello sir, so that was really an informative session which you have given, and that has given really a different perspective altogether. So I would like to ask, how soon should I start? As of now my son is 5 years old, so but how soon we should start this planning?
I always say I think you should start it today. Because as I said, there are two aspects. See, we are planning what after us. It does not have any timeline, right? Because if something happens, it can happen today. It can happen tomorrow, later on. Your preparedness has to be there today. Your framework should be ready today, right? Similarly, on the financial side, also you would be ready today, because there is a time. It takes time to accumulate funds for your child. Unless and until you have some inheritance coming in, you require time. So you can only do proper planning when you plan it today. So my answer to that is that you start planning today, have the framework ready. Okay, you can make it functional within your lifetime. Mm-hmm. And if the situation arises, I think the things can be managed more smoothly.
Yeah, so how do we start the financial planning at this stage? Like, how do I calculate what should be the corpus required in the
okay.
future?
So see, for simple calculations, we have prepared an online calculator. So you can go to the calculator. It just tell you, what is the money required today, the total corpus required. That's a simple calculator to understand. So it just give you a broad, thinking that, okay, yeah, this much money I should have today. For a comprehensive planning, you will have to go through a planning exercise, that we do for all families, where we engage them for the financial planning, prepare plans, analyze finances, and then we draw the roadmap.
Okay, and sorry, last question is,
yeah.
We see the letter of intent will change as the child grows, right? So
yeah.
When do we have to finalize it, and the legal
letter,
guardian, yeah.
Okay, letter of intent you finalize today, it has to be reviewed and updated periodically.
Okay.
So as of now, so it is prepared in Word document. You have to just, you know, convert it into a PDF, and that Word document you keep on revising at regular intervals.
Right. And similarly, legal guardians also, they might change over the course of a couple of years, right? So they might, we might be comfortable. And I have an elder son also. So once he's actually, he's an adult or he's responsible, so I would prefer him to be his legal guardian. But obviously he's,
So you can change in the, so legal guardian you are appointing in the will. Will you can change n number of times. So you can change the legal guardian tomorrow.
Got it. Thanks a lot, sir.
Any more question? I can see in chat box, but I mean, can I take it? Can I open bank account for my dependent child? What are the requirements?
So is he minor or major? Rajendra Bombay, so what is the age of the child?
Yeah, you can unmute, sir. Rajendra.
Oh, major, 19 years old.
19 years old. Yes, you can open a bank account for your son under the legal guardianship. So when you go open a bank account, for your child, they will ask for you for the legal guardianship certificate. That will be required. So your account will be, you know, much like minor account you open, you know, child name under guardianship. So here also it will be on the child name under legal guardianship, but you will require the legal guardianship certificate.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Amrapali Mate, ma'am, you can unmute and ask.
My child is a 5 year old and I have only one child. So how can I think about her to appoint a legal guardian for her?
Okay, so legal guardian, there are two aspects. One is the legal aspect and the second is whom you can appoint. Now, there are foundation legally, as far as I know, that legal guardianship first has to be the blood relatives. So if you have any family member, blood relatives available, you can appoint them as the legal guardian. Otherwise, you know, from the friend circle or from others, you will have to, you can appoint. But probably you will have to seek, that permission from the court.
Okay. My blood relative will be there, so I don't have to seek permission from the court, right?
So you can appoint in your will, right? In your will, it is, you know, they will be, appointed as a legal guardian, and whatever you write in the will, you know, that is considered legally valid. You might have to, so if you have taken a legal guardianship from National Trust yourself, you might have, you know, they might have to update the will with the National Trust.
Okay.
So just updation would be required. They might not have to apply, you know, for legal guardianship, but to update the will. So you can appoint in your will, you know, anyone as a legal guardian.
Okay, right. I'm getting. And one more question. Just suggestion I want. Ki if parents like me, the only child they have, so how should they go for to choose a legal guardian? Just advice.
Sorry, come again on that question.
Parents like me who have the only one child, so how should they go for the in the process of choosing a legal guardian? How could we go?
Okay, so legal guardian, whenever you are appointing a legal guardian, especially for, you know,
girl child.
So I'll, you know, probably advise that the financials should be kept separate, not to give legal guardian all responsibilities on personal and financial side. That is, you know, one thing which you always should consider, that try out, you know, forming a trust and putting the financial in the trust. Let the trust manage the financial, and legal guardian you appoint only for personal affairs, because that way the trust is always there, right? They might not be the, you know, the legal authority to manage the personal affairs, but the trust will always be there. And trust me, the advantage is that much like legal guardianship, you have a foundation of, I mean, appointing immediate family relatives or some inner trustee. You can appoint anybody as a trustee. So even your friend come in as a trustee, and, you know, in an informal way, he can always, you know, keep a watch on the child affairs.
Right. Okay.
That way you can do.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Next question, I would be taking Rashmi and auntie. I know her. Can you have more than one guardian and also more than one trustee?
Okay. A trustee, minimum two are required, and you can have n number of trustees. So trustees is not no foundation. Can you have more than one guardian? Yes, you can appoint two guardian, you know, simultaneously in your will. If you do not want to, you know, want to give responsibility only to one person, you can appoint two guardians simultaneously. But how will they manage, you know, who is going to be the final authority to sign documents, both? So all that question will have to be discussed with legal experts. But to my mind, you can have better, I always say, you know, you can look at an alternative. So you can appoint one and second can be an alternative. But two legal guardians, you can appoint. I don't think, you know, there should be a legal issue in appointing more than one guardian. But you have to see that what objective it will solve, because as I said, you appoint one legal guardian and bring in other as a trustee in your private trust, that can also serve the purpose.
Okay, next, Amit, you can ask your question. Okay, we cannot hear you. Can't hear you. You are unmuted, but can't hear you. Okay, we'll move.
Okay, Rashmi, what I mean was, say two siblings. I think in case of two siblings, you can appoint both of them as a legal guardian. If there is a but probably, you know, having one as a legal guardian and second as a alternate, that might be an option. Also, it also depends on whether you are also giving the financial responsibility to both of them, or you are creating a private trust and leaving financial to the private trust. In that case, if you are leaving a private trust, you might have one as a legal guardian. But if you are giving financial responsibility also, then yes, you can appoint both as a guardian for your child, after your lifetime.
Next question is from Amit. I wanted to ask, how can I build a trust for my child?
Okay. So first of all, you will have to consider who are going to be the trustees for your child. Identify those trustees now or in the future. So initially you can be the trustees, but in the future, who is going to be the trustees? So you need to work on that, set up the objective, of the trust. Okay, you have a younger son, so he can't come in today. He will come in as the future trustees, maybe after once he's 18 years of age. Till that time, you can identify someone other as a trustee. And, once you identify that, then you have to create a trust deed. You have to draft a trust deed and either get it notarized or get it registered. And then your trust is, open a bank account, a trust is functional. But as far as deciding on the trustees, yes, you can be the initial trustee. So you can be the initial trustee and your son can come in later on. You will require two trustees to start with. You or somebody else can come in and your son can come in later on. And you can mention in the trust also that he is going to be the trustee once he is 18 years of age. Guardian can be trustee. There is no legal foundation as the legal guardian can become one of the trustees. There is no legal foundation in that.
Okay. There's, I think, question from Shubhangi Sahu, ma'am. You can go ahead and ask your question.
Hello, sir. Namaskar. Good evening to all. Sir, mera question hai. What happened after us? My child is 37 years old, Down syndrome baby. Girl child. Okay. लेकिन हमारा यहाँ सर, मैं भुवन सर से बोल रही हूँ, ओडिशा भुवन सर से. हमारा एक पेरेंट्स एसोसिएशन भी है मेंटल डिटर्ड का. लेकिन सबका क्वेश्चन होता है, व्हाट आफ्टर आज, ये क्या क्वेश्चन, ये का आंसर बिल्कुल नहीं मिलता. हम लोग बहुत सारे जो मीटिंग आया है, नेशनल ट्रस्ट मीटिंग आया है, परिवार में मैं शामिल हूँ सर, परिवार जो हमारा हो, लेकिन ये आंसर अभी तक हम लोग को मिला नहीं. देखो, हम लोग का बच्चों का कहाँ लेंगे, क्या करेंगे, फ्यूचर क्या होगा। और जो लीगल गार्जियनशिप बोलते हैं ना सर, मैं लीगल गार्जियनशिप बना दी, मैंने ही खुद मेरी बेटी का लीगल गार्जियन हूँ। लेकिन मेरे आफ्टर मी मो कॉल माने व्हाट हैपेंड माय चाइल्ड माने बेबी गर्ल, माने सिक्योरिटी क्या है, सेफ्टी क्या है, ये आंसर हम लोग कभी नहीं दे पाते हैं सर। बार बार मीटिंग होता है लेकिन लास्ट कंक्लूजन में हम कुछ नहीं पहुंच पाते हैं।
देखिए, इसका आंसर ना किसी के पास है नहीं, बिकॉज रेजिडेंशियल लिविंग कहाँ पर होगा। अगेन आफ्टर पेरेंट्स, अगर आपका खुद का घर है वहां पे हो सकता है, सर्विस प्रोवाइडर्स के साथ दो ही ऑप्शन बचते हैं, एक तो वो सिचुएशन है या फिर कोई रेजिडेंशियल लिविंग केयर अगर हो तो उसमें वो रह सकता है। अनलेस एंड अनटिल ये ऑप्शन नहीं होंगे तो ये आंसर किसी के पास नहीं होगा कि यू नो क्या होगा चाइल्ड का, वो कहाँ रहेगा। तो ये रेजिडेंशियल, इसीलिए मैंने कहा कि सबसे पहला एस्पेक्ट वो रेजिडेंशियल लिविंग का है, राइट। रेजिडेंशियल लिविंग कहाँ होगा, अभी इन सब के ऊपर डेवलपमेंट चल रहा है, बहुत सारी पेरेंट कम्युनिटीज काम कर रही हैं, रेजिडेंशियल केयर होम बन रहे हैं, अदर
अभी भी हम लोग ट्राई करते हैं। अभी रेजिडेंशियल के लिए गवर्नमेंट को हम लिखा हुआ है, गवर्नमेंट ये सोचता नहीं सर, हमारे जो आईडी बच्चे के लिए खास करके
गवर्नमेंट पे डिपेंडेंट मत रहिए।
नहीं सर, एक क्वेश्चन है सर, आजकल का जो वैक्सीन निकला है, वैक्सीन मान ऑल ओवर अवेयरनेस हो रहा है, लेकिन हमारे बच्चे के लिए कोई सोचता है सर क्या, कोई सोचता है जो हमारा जो वैक्सीन हमारे बच्चों के लिए एप्रोप्रिएट है कि नहीं, जिसका लिए एपिलेप्स है, जिसका लिए फिट्स है, जिसका इम्यूनिट नहीं है, ये जो वैक्सीन निकल रहा है ये वैक्सीन देना चाहिए या नहीं देना चाहिए, ये हमारा मन में आज 10 दिन तक हो गया सर। हम लोग का अभी आज में मेरा अपना ये का साथ बात किया है, मैंने कमिश्नर का साथ, डिजर्वेड कमिश्नर साथ,
कहीं और जा रहा है हमारा डिस्कशन। मुझे समझ में आ रहा है कि आपको गवर्नमेंट से मिलने से ज्यादा हमें पेरेंट्स ने इसको इनिशिएट,
हमको क्या करेंगे सर, गवर्नमेंट छोड़िए, गवर्नमेंट का कुछ नहीं,
खुद एक साथ आके पेरेंट्स ने इस पे काम करना बहुत जरूरी है मैम,
जरूरी है।
यस यस, जैसे अभी मैं खुद एक पेरेंट हूँ, मैंने अपना एक फाउंडेशन ओपन किया है, इसी तरह से खुद ने आके जब तक हम लोग इसमें एक साथ आके काम नहीं करेंगे ये नहीं हो पाएगा। ये मैं हर मीटिंग में आएगी इसमें बोलती हूँ कि एक साथ आके काम करना चाहिए।
हाँ, हाँ।
अभी ये टाइम ही है कि अभी हम किसी पे डिपेंडेंट,
आई थिंक सी डाउन सिंड्रोम के लिए जो डाउन सिंड्रोम फेडरेशन है ना, रेखा मैम
करके,
हाँ तो कहीं ना कहीं अब जैसे और डिसेबिलिटीज में पेरेंट्स कम्युनिटी ने आके आगे काम किया है, रेजिडेंशियल केयर होम बनाए हैं, आज वेट फॉर सर्टेन टाइम प्रॉब्ली यू नो कुछ ना कुछ डेवलपमेंट होगा डाउन सिंड्रोम्स के लिए भी और दूसरी डिसेबिलिटीज के लिए भी, कहीं ना कहीं प्राइवेट इंस्टीट्यूशंस आएंगे। गवर्नमेंट से मैं बहुत ज्यादा एक्सपेक्टेशन नहीं कर सकता,
मतलब नहीं है,
गवर्नमेंट इंस्टीट्यूशन ऑलरेडी थे, उनकी हालत हमने देखी है, वहां से ज्यादा नहीं, बट वेट फॉर सम टाइम वो डेवलपमेंट हो रहा है। आई थिंक ये डाउन सिंड्रोम के लिए भी कुछ ना कुछ यू नो सॉल्यूशन विल कम इन एज फार एज रेजिडेंशियल केयर होम्स।
यस सर, थैंक यू। आफ्टर मी और लीगल गार्जियनशिप चेंज हो सकता है, माने मेरे के बाद?
हाँ, आपके बाद तो आप विल में लिख के जाओगे, आप लीगल गार्जियनशिप चेंज नहीं होगा। लीगल गार्जियनशिप अगर आप नहीं लिख के जाओगे तो किसी और ब्लड रिलेटिव को जाके लीगल गार्जियनशिप लेना पड़ेगा, बट आपको विल में लिखना पड़ेगा कि कौन लीगल गार्जियन होगा।
ओके ओके, थैंक यू सर, thank you so much
sir. Just quick two questions I can see, whether guardian can be trustee?
It is no legal foundation in that, guardian trustee bhi ho sakta hai.
Where to go for this trust, Avneet ji hai puch rahe hain.
Where to go for this trust, so we help in trust formation, we also provide trusteeship services, so we have got a company called Special Need Estate Planners Private Limited जो सिर्फ स्पेशल चिल्ड्रन फैमिलीज के लिए काम करती है, एंड ऑन द लीगल फ्रेमवर्क, सो वी फॉर्म अ विल, वी ड्राफ्ट अ विल, वी ड्राफ्ट अ ट्रस्ट, वी फॉर्म अ ट्रस्ट, वी आल्सो एक्ट एज अ ट्रस्टी, प्लस वी आल्सो हैव एन एडवाइजरी फॉर द ट्रस्टीज आल्सो, वी कैन एडवाइज ट्रस्टीज हाउ टू मैनेज द अफेयर्स। तो यू कैन राइट यू नो टू माई कंपनी, आई विल गिव यू द ईमेल आईडी फॉर द ट्रस्ट एंड देन यू कैन टेक द डिटेल। You can write at this and Okay, sorry, you said 1 second. And you will get the details. So we'll help you in formation of a trust.
Yes, sir. Any individual questions, you can directly contact to sir on this email ID. If you are in group, that you can contact him there on his number also. Yes, I think any more questions? Otherwise, we can stop here today. Okay, sir. I think we can stop here, and we will see you on next Friday. Yeah, next Friday. Yes. There, everyone. We are having another good topic. I'll be sharing in the group. Already shared, but still I'm sharing here. Understanding life stages of your special needs time. So same time next Friday. See you all, and thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Very informative session. Thank you everyone for joining. Good night and bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you.